you as a travel writer are claiming that the best steak you've had is in Tacoma.
Welcome to the Exploring Washington State podcast. Here's your host, Scott Cowan.
All right, well, welcome back to this episode of the Exploring Washington State podcast. Today, my guest is Peggy Cleveland. Peggy is an author. We're going to let her talk about the book title in a little bit. But Peggy lives in the Steilacoom area. And Peggy, why don't you tell our audience how you ended up in Steilacoom? I mean, that's a long, broad story, but let's, you know, why Steilacoom?
Well, it's kind of a crazy story. So I've actually moved 33 times, and I started out in California. I was a Navy brat, so moved around quite a bit with my father. And then I served for 12 years, so that added on to the moves. And then I met my husband in Korea, and we moved, continued to move. And, you know, as we were getting closer to retirement, for his military retirement, you know, it was always like, where do you want to live? Where do you want to live? And we were just having a really hard time deciding. And then our last duty station was Joint Base Lewis-McChord, which is near Tacoma. And it's the top duty station in the Army, top requested station. And so we had tried his whole career to get stationed here. And so once we got here, we just fell in love with it. And Steilacoom is located not too far from the base. And so everything just kind of fell into place, and we ended up buying our forever home here in Steilacoom.
Now, I've lived in the shadow, well, of McChord Field before. When I grew up, it was McChord in Fort Lewis. So I lived in the shadow of McChord Field. And I would like to know why, because I understand it's popular, but why is Joint Base McChord Lewis the number one destination? What is it about it that is attractive?
I think for me, you know, growing up, I lived most of the time after we moved from California on the East Coast, and I've just always loved all the national parks and everything out west. So I think I know that's what drew us, that we really wanted to come out here.
All right.
And then, you know, on my husband's side, it was good job opportunities and things like that as well within the military.
Okay. Now, when I was doing a little research for this episode, I saw a very, I'll use the word odd, photograph of you standing in North Korea.
Oh, that's true. So when I was stationed in Korea, you would have the opportunity to go up to the border and take these tours. And so part of the tour takes you, there's a United Nations building that sits right on the border. And when you go inside the building, you have the opportunity to walk to the other side in the building, and you're actually standing in North Korea. And of course, you know, being blonde hair, blue eyes, and that was a lot younger then, you definitely drew, you know, the guards would come up and just stare at all the Americans that were in the building.
That just seems like such a weird...
It was very, very weird, yeah, you know, especially seems... knowing... I can't remember when it happened, if it was the 60s or 70s, but there was a border incident, and some Americans were attacked by the North Koreans, and it was a pretty brutal situation. So you kind of think about that when you're standing on that side of it.
I don't know. I guess if I was there, I'd probably do this. I'd probably go stand there too, just to say I've been there. It's like I can say I've been to Georgia. Simply because I drove across the state line, there was an exit, turned around, and went back. But I've been to Georgia. That's
yeah, it counts if you actually been there. If you flew over it, it doesn't count.
Yeah, it doesn't count if you flew. Or I also say if I'm just at the airport, I don't typically count those states either. If I've just been to the airport, but Georgia, I literally drove across the state line. There was an exit not too far, just looped around back. It was like I was probably there 5 minutes. You know, so that's maybe my equivalent of your North Korea. That sounds more exciting than Georgia, I guess. <Yeah. laughs>
It was pretty exciting. And it was just so bizarre because North Korea is, you know, continue to suffer from famine. And so I just can't imagine what they would think, because you would see the North Korean soldiers, and I'm sure you could see in the picture, so they were just paper thin.
Yes, they were.
And on the border were the most trustworthy soldiers. So these were the elite ones, and they were that thin. I can't even imagine what the rest of the army would look like. Yeah. And so when you're standing on the border and you look into North Korea, it's just brown, like every tree, braided grass, everything, you know, it's just like people have eaten everything. And then you turn around and you look at South Korea, and it's just like super lush. And then the South Korean soldiers are very buff and healthy looking. And I just can't imagine what you would think, you know, if you were on that other side of the border looking into South Korea.
When did you decide that you wanted to become a travel writer? Was it because you moved 30 plus times in your life, or what was the inspiration?
Well, when I first was in the Army, I was in the reserves and I was a photojournalist for the Army. And then, you know, as time went on, I've always loved travel, especially as a child, you know, some of the adventures we had moving. It's just been something that's been a passion of mine my whole life. And so I kind of fell into the opportunity when we got out here. I was volunteering for the Spouses Club, and our auction was celebrating the 100th anniversary of Camp Lewis. Mm-hmm. And so there was a local newspaper called The Ranger and The Airlifter. You might be familiar with
it. Familiar with us.
And it's not owned by the military. It's actually a civilian family. Nobody served in the military, but they've had this newspaper for, I think, definitely over 50 years. And so they were doing a magazine for the 100th anniversary. And so I reached out to them. I said, our event has this theme. You know, do you think we could possibly get a free ad for our nonprofit about this event? And they said, no. And I said, well, I write. Do you think we could work a trade, you know, where I could contribute an article, because I've already been researching some for our program. And so they said, well, you'll have to talk with our publisher. So I emailed him, and then he emailed me back and he says, I want to meet with you to talk with you about writing for us. And I was thinking, well, that wasn't the, you know, the plan, but I still wanted to get this ad for our event. So I agreed to meet him for coffee and everything. And the man hadn't read a word I'd written before. And so we started talking, and he was telling me how he hired stringers, a lot of times military spouses, which was a great opportunity for us. And then my boys were still in high school, so I wasn't planning on going back to work yet. But he just reeled me in. He's like, well, you can write one article a week, one article a month, you know, whatever you feel like. And then, you know, so if you want to take a couple weeks off, you know, just let us know. No problem. There's no pressure. And so it's sounding better and better. And then he says, well, what's your long-term goals? And I said, oh, I've always wanted to be a travel writer. And he says, well, by the way, we do travel in the newspaper, and we're really trying to plus that up. And so they would run, at that time, they would run one travel article a week. And, the paper was kind of small, so it only had, you know, maybe 10 articles. So to get that article each week was really a nice opportunity for me. And then he mentioned how different destinations will host you, you know, if you want to come visit and everything. So he just reeled me right in. So that's how I got my start. And then so I started, you know, day trips, weekend trips, things that would appeal to the military. And then they would do these... throughout the year, they would do guides that were a little bit longer. And so in those, I could do, you know, like an 8-hour driving trip or things like that. So then it kind of expanded regionally. And then I freelance. So I worked my way into a couple other opportunities. And now I write for this company called Travel Awaits. And it's for the over 50 traveler. Mm-hmm. And then it's written by over 50 writers. And then that opened up a lot of opportunities for me for international trips and everything. So now with this book, I feel like I'm a real travel writer now.
That's awesome. Well, let me put you on the spot. So when you started writing for I'll just call it The Ranger, because I always forgot The Airlifter. It was always, you know, the Ranger. Anyway. Where were some of the interesting places that you went that were kind of a day trip, if you will, from post?
Oh, wow. Well, just so as part of that, when I was working with the Spouses Club, I ran a little group called the Pacific Northwest Explorers. And so with the ladies, I would plan trips that would start after school, they dropped everybody off for school and then we'd get back, you know, before school got out. So we did things like one time we would go see the salmon run at Tumwater Falls, which I think is, you know, you kind of take it for granted living here, but you read about that in biology and learn about the salmon run and the spawning and, you know, this just epic life and death adventure. But to see it, you know, in real life is pretty impressive. Let's see, day trips. Oh, wow. Just all over. I've even gone all the way out to the Olympic Peninsula to Nia Bay. Okay. It's almost, I think, a 4-hour drive, and I've done that in a day with a friend just to see it. So there's just so many great things. I mean, you can zip up to Mount Rainier in a day, and that's what I love about living in the Tacoma area because it's kind of branded Mountain City Sea. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. so you can go up to the mountain, you know, towards Mount Rainier in the morning and go hiking and then come back down in the afternoon and kayak right outside the city.
As long as you don't go on Meridian. If you drive on Meridian, you're not going to be able to. I'm just going to put that out there that you can't.
And then in the evening, you can go see, you know, a Broadway show or one of the local theater shows.
It really is when you think about it that you can go from, you know, the Pacific Ocean to the highest peak in the continental United States, and you could see them both. It'd be a long incredible. Day, but you could do it. You know, you could do it. Yeah. Well, let's transition into, so the title of your new book is going to be called 100 Things to Do in Tacoma Before You Die. That's kind of a morbid title, I got to tell you. You know.
Well, the publishing company is Reedy Press, and they reached out to Travel Tacoma, which markets the Tacoma area for tourism, and asked them to recommend a writer. And they recommended me, which I was really happy about.
That's awesome.
And yeah, it was pretty overwhelming. So they actually have that brand, 100 Things to Do Before You Die. Okay. And so it's kind of it's actually got a real cult following because they do a lot of the they do have the big cities, but they also focus on a lot of the cities like Tacoma size. So I think it's a lot of guidebooks for cities that you don't normally see. Right. And so people just really like it. It's just a really set formatted layout and every book's the same.
Okay.
You know, except for the city. So, but the layout's the same.
So how was the experience going from being a freelance writer of online articles or, you know, paper print to being now a book author? What about the experience was different?
Well, I think this was actually pretty easy. Years and years ago, I wrote a novel with my sister, and this was our kind of Gone with the Wind, War and Peace, you know, just crazy long book. And I got that out of my system. So this one, this one was relatively easy because it's 160 pages. So basically, each entry is about 150 words, and you're not doing the nuts and bolts of, oh, this is open, you know, Monday through Sunday. You just try and come up with some unique little hook to describe that place in that few words. So it's that part of it was challenging. But as far as writing, it went pretty smooth. I had visited most of the places already. So it was pretty easy for me to come up with my list. And then I reached out to local people as well to get some input.
Impossible question. I know what I'm about to ask is impossible, but play along.
Okay.
Out of those 100, what's your favorite?
Oh, Lord.
See, I know it's impossible, but what for you, like what?
Okay. I think for me, and this would kind of be like a combo, but I feel like Point Defiance Park is the crown jewel of Tacoma. Mm-hmm. And it's just absolutely just stunning. It's an old growth forest. I can't remember. I want to say there's at least 8 separate gardens in there. Rhododendron garden, Nadalia garden. There's even a Pacific Northwest garden, Japanese garden. Absolutely stunning. And then within the park, you have the zoo. You have a replica fort and a beach. So you pretty much have everything there. And then if you kind of combine that with Point Reston now, and they're connected by a bridge, you can head to Point Reston to restaurants and shops and, of course, ice cream at Ice Cream Social, which made the book. So, I think that's probably my my favorite.
That would be your.
I can confidently say that.
if someone were dropped at your doorstep and the goal was to take them to one place in Tacoma, you'd probably go up there.
Yes. Yeah. That's always on the list.
Yeah.
And then kind of some quirky ones too. Like I always take people to the Brown and Haley factory to go to the factory outlet, which I don't know if a lot of people realize, but the outlet is actually the old ticket booth from the Seattle World's Fair. And there was a movie, I think it was called At the World's Fair or something like that, with Elvis in it. So Elvis Presley's actually was in that ticket booth. I guess they used it kind of like a green room or staging room for him to get away from the crowds while they were filming the movie.
I did not know that was a repurposed building. I had no idea. Oh, that's okay.
Yeah,
that's pretty neat. That is neat. Well, what else? Let's you know, we're not going to go through all 100, obviously, but like what else? What, give us, for somebody who's listening who hasn't been to Tacoma, give us kind of in your opinion, the flavor of Tacoma. We got Point Defiance. Well, we've already done that.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the things I really love about Tacoma, and I just kind of noticed it as I was exploring over the years, is you'll just be driving and suddenly you feel like you're in like a separate little mini main street where you have like these separate neighborhood districts. And there is actually, I want to say there's 14 or 15 of them. And so that's one entry in the book. So you have like the Lincoln District, the Stadium District, and each of them has a unique flavor. You'll find little restaurants and shops, and that's where the locals go because that's in their neighborhood. So I thought that was something unique about Tacoma that I hadn't experienced anywhere else I'd lived. And so I love that aspect of these neighborhoods having their own little like mini small towns almost within Tacoma. And then let's see, it's just such a unique city, and I love the diversity of it. So my husband and I met in Korea, so we learned to really love the Korean food. So I love to go to, it's called the Lakewood International District, but it's kind of known as Koreatown, and there's just so many Korean barbecue restaurants there. And then there's Paldo World, which is a big Asian grocery store, but in it has this little food court, and in the back is this place called Mandu World, and there's this young man, and all he makes is mandu, which is a Korean kind of like bun or dumpling. It's kind of, you know, kind of heavy, and it's you know, filled with either pork, spicy pork, or bean curd. That's all he sells, but they're so good, and that's all he needs to sell. So he's got a little cult following here in Tacoma. Okay.
Now, it's funny that when I think of that district in Tacoma, I'm primarily thinking of South Tacoma Way.
But yes, and that's kind of where Koreatown is, you know, South Tacoma Way area.
I just, in that area, I grew up in Tacoma, and I left Tacoma in 1980 to go to college. So that's, you know, going, you know, way back. And that South Tacoma Way at that time was a lot of used car lots aimed towards aimed towards military buyers, cheap cars, will finance, basically, in my opinion, to take advantage of the enlisted guys who weren't being the citizens of Tacoma weren't being kind to the military. How's that? But at that time in the early 80s, it began to transition to having this more international footprint. And now when I go through South Tacoma Way, I'm kind of like, wow, the transformation's staggering to me, how it's, I love coffee, and that will be a question in a little bit, but I can't think of the name of this place. It was in strip mall.
Is it in South Tacoma Way?
Yes.
And does it look kind of like a farmhouse decor inside?
This is in a strip mall next to like an auto insurance, you know, Pemco auto insurance. I mean, it was just this bizarre strip mall, and somebody had recommended go there, it's great coffee. And so I went there with a friend of mine, and I was just like, I don't know, from the outside it just had this weird vibe to me. And we walk inside, and I've just entered the door from going in from a strip mall inside, and it's this pastel yellows and white trim, electric fireplace in the back, instrumental music playing. And their specialty was sweet potato lattes.
Oh, and I've been there. I've been there. And I know what you mean. The decor, it doesn't fit what you expect for Koreatown. It's very...
So I was sitting there, and I don't drink lattes. I just, my thing at the time, I was doing 100 cups of coffee in 100 days throughout Washington State. So okay. I had coffee. It was very good coffee. And I'm looking at these two early 20-something-year-olds working there, right? And I'm sitting there with a friend of mine. We're talking, and the music's playing in the background. And it's just, like I said, just this piano music playing. And I was listening to it. And they had found a instrumental Muzak version, and not even Muzak, but just somebody playing the piano like to like bands like Linkin Park and the punk rock, heavy, not heavy metal, but just like 90s alternative rock and roll being played by a little piano. And so all I'm thinking is these two 20-something-year-olds are going, well, we have to stand here and be in this really boring place, but we'll listen to what we like. it was just kind of this interesting experience to me. And it was, and I wish I could remember the name of it, but I honestly can't. But you've been there, and
I can't remember the name of it, but I did try the sweet potato latte. It's, it was really interesting. It's not quite my thing because I don't really like a sweet drink, but I heard so many people talk about it. Like, I had to try it. And so I think if you like a sweeter coffee, it was very interesting. And like I said, it wasn't my thing, but I could see why people really like it.
Well, I just ordered black coffee, which is what I was doing at the time. But the presentation was phenomenal. I mean, they brought it out on a tray, it was a French press. And it was like, I'm looking around going, this is not from outside. To inside, this is not what I expected. It was, I need to go back. But I'm going to put you on the spot. We're going to shift gears to something I would ask you typically a little later, but we're talking food. You're going to take somebody to lunch in Tacoma, put you on the spot. Lunch. Give me a couple of suggestions for interesting food in Tacoma for lunches.
I think, talking for someone probably that's visiting Tacoma and you might be doing the museum district, I would go to Incalmo, which is in the Museum of Glass. And it's actually fabulous. I'm trying to remember what the restaurant was on Tacoma that closed. Was it the Pacific Grill, yes. Mm-hmm. So they used to run that. And then when they closed, it was closed for a while. And so now the table on 6th Avenue, it's an offshoot of that. And so the table's pretty renowned in Tacoma's being a great place to eat. So the food there is awesome. So it's kind of a coffee shop, bakery, and then they have some great salads and other foods as well. So I really enjoy it. And the view's beautiful, you know, and you're right there at the Glass Museum. So,
well, let's go back because I'm not familiar really with Korean food. So let's say it's me and I said, hey, I want to try Korean food. Like where would I go and what should I have in Tacoma?
Okay. So, Paldo World's fun because you can go in the food court and there's a Japanese, a Chinese, and then a Korean, I guess, kind of kiosk there.
Okay.
So I think the traditional, like, Korean bulgogi, my husband just loves. I love that, too. It's kind of a sweet barbecue-flavored meat that's cooked up and served with rice. And then Korean food, too. They do a lot of the soups, with noodles or I'm trying to think what's... you know, with the eggs popped in them and stuff. But we love going out for Korean barbecue, but that would be more a dinner thing.
All right, you can talk me into dinner. I mean, so Korean barbecue.
Well, so South Tacoma way, you really can't go wrong with it. There's just, you drive along and you'll just see Korean barbecue. And you go in and it's kind of like, you know how the hibachi grills are, the Japanese, but this one you actually have a round thing in the table that's turned on and run off gas, and then they serve the meat to you raw, and then you just cook it right in front of you, and then it's served with I guess it's called banchan, I think is the word, but it's all these like little side dishes like kimchi and just a variety of different things, and it works out really well because my husband likes half of them and I like the other half, so we usually split it pretty well. But it's usually all you can eat too, so that was always really popular with the soldiers too. So,
okay, yeah, I've just it's something I haven't tried. I mean, and it's
yeah, it's really good fun. I really enjoy it. It's and plus it brings back a lot of memories, you know, because we were stationed there, so
we've
always enjoyed the culture too.
All right.
And then, of course, if you're down on South Tacoma Way, you have to go in Shinchin to go shopping. And that's a Korean kind of shopping center. And you go in, and it's so funny when you read the reviews, because a lot of people say, oh, they're so racist. They follow you around, you know, the whole time you're in the store. But that's the Korean culture. So you go in, and somebody will immediately greet you, you know, after you've been there a couple minutes, and help you out. And I always end up buying stuff I never planned on buying, because they'll show you something really cool. But it's got everything in there, from all the different dishes, you know, that you would serve Korean food with, to blank, I've seen aprons. There's all kinds of housekeeping things that are just kind of really interesting. And then Korean face care, you know, or skin care is really popular now. So you can find it, and you can get those Korean face masks that look like paper, you know, masks that people put on their faces. And they're usually, you know, pretty pricey at other places, but you can find them for like a dollar there. So there's great prices. So that's a place I like to take if somebody's visiting, especially if they have kids. That's just a really fun place to go.
All right.
With the book, who's the target audience for the book? Is it for people that are coming to the area, or is it more for like people in the area that, you know, like these were a little bit more?
I think I think it's both. It's for visitors, but also for people that live here. I think a lot of times people live somewhere and they just kind of forget what's in their city. And I think especially during COVID, people are starting to like re-explore where they live. But I think I was the perfect person to write it, because as a military family, like a lot of people don't realize how much military families travel when they get to a destination, and how much tourism dollars they bring in, because usually their families come to visit them. So, you know, it's pretty typical. You'll move somewhere and then all your relatives will come visit you. And they look forward to that too. But so as a military family, you move into the area, so you start to know it like a local, but you still have the fresh eyes of a tourist. So you kind of quickly find out what are the things you have to see. And you want to do it as fast as possible, because you're only going to be somewhere for, you know, 2 or 3 years. So you need to see as much as you can, because you may never be here again. So,
all right. Well, that's, you know, now that's funny. Not growing up in a military family, that's an interesting viewpoint that you just brought up, because you're right. Somebody gets a, you know, duty station for 2 years, and I don't want to say it's a long vacation. I don't mean it like that, but it's they know they're going to be there from, let's say, October of 22 to October 24, blah, blah. It's like, well, when we're working, we're going to work, but we're off, let's go explore.
Well, we would typically take a day trip, usually on the weekends, and then maybe 1 week in a month, or every other month, we'd take a weekend getaway. And then anytime there were longer vacations, you know, you'd get out and, you know, do a longer driving trip and everything. So, I really liked it. But one thing I love about Tacoma, so typically for me, I've moved so much, and after a while at a destination, I'll be like, oh, I've got the go bug. I'm ready to move, you know, go somewhere else. But I've been here, I think, almost 8 years now, and I feel like I'm still just scratching the surface of everything to see and do in Washington in this area.
Okay. So. Have you done much? Have you gone to Eastern Washington much at all?
A little bit. I've been to the Tri-Cities, Walla Walla. In fact, I'm going to Yakima this Thursday to work on a travel story for that area.
The Palm Springs of Washington. That's the byline.
Well, I think it's kind of underrated, though. Like, I don't think people realize, like, some of their wine coming out of there is just incredible. You know, it ranks up there some of the best in the state, I think. And then most of the hops in the country are grown there in the Yakima Valley.
Have you ever been to Tyotin?
No, I don't think I've even heard of it.
So Tyotin, okay. Well, so when you go to Yakima on Thursday, how are you going to go there? Are you going to go across
Snoqualmie?
Yeah, but you're going to go across
Snoqualmie Pass. And,
down to Ellensburg and then come up 84 probably. Okay, there. All right. So, how do I want to describe it? Tyotin is west of Yakima. okay. on the way to White Pass, which is the other mountain pass that you can go over.
Okay. Right.
And it's up on a plateau. And it is an agricultural community.
Okay.
But 15 years ago or so, they started some people. Well, there's a long story, and we've talked to numerous people on the podcast before, so I'll just give the super high level of it. But they started going there. Well, it happened because how this all happened, the real quick story is the guy was riding his bicycle. He was an avid bike rider, and he had multiple flat tires, and he had to stop, and he was patching the tires while he was sitting in the town square of Tayatin. He was looking around going, wow, all these buildings are empty. Well, they ended up starting to buy up all the buildings and them into artist studios. And he's a book publisher, and so he publishes books out of Tayatin, and they have a mercantile there and art galleries and all this stuff, and they've turned it into this really interesting artsy community. But it's very, I don't want to say this, it's not artsy and highbrow. It's very, very, still very local, still very agricultural centered. It's an amazing little town. It's so much fun to
check it out. I'm always looking for something new to write about. So
and they didn't do it this year, unfortunately, but they have what's called the Tayatin Grand Prix, which is where people build these replica early 20th century 1910, 20, 30s race cars using six horsepower engines, and then they race around town in them.
Oh, that sounds funny.
Yeah, and it's just this really cool community that, you know, that I find to be just a lot of fun to go and visit. And it's, you know, 15 miles west of Yakima. So, anyway, not to detract from Yakima. But Yakima, so like you were mentioning, the wines. I realized this, but I didn't realize it. I mean, some huge percentage of the hops grown in North America are grown in Yakima County. Right. It's just staggering. And it really is becoming a very interesting place to go and explore. So you'll have fun, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. So.
But I get a kick out of that sign that says the Palm Springs of Washington. I just always just, you know, as I was shaking my head and laughing at that. And I had a guest on, and they actually explained to me why they felt it was the Palm. And I was like, okay, that's actually a really good explanation. You win. I'll stop making fun of Yakima.
Yeah. Well, I think, what was I going to say? Oh, getting back to the book, you know, being selected to write this book, but it was also kind of stressful because, you know, one thing I love about Tacoma, I love all the diversity, but people are very passionate about the city. And so, you know, I'm just like, I'm the one to pick these 100 things. So I know there's going to be people upset I left something out, but it's really hard to... you know, narrow it down because it's such a great area. And so there's five categories. There's food and drink, sports and recreation, culture and history, shopping and fashion. And I'm missing one. Let's see. I'm trying to remember what the other one was. So let's see, food and drink, sports, recreation, culture and history. Oh, music and entertainment. Okay. So, and that was the one I was kind of hesitant with because I wasn't really familiar with the music scene in the town. So I actually reached out to some locals with Pretty Gritty Tours, and then also Grit City Magazine, because they kind of have a handle on everything going on in town. And so they recommended a couple DJs that I reached out to. And so they gave me some insight into a couple places. So that's
Tacoma's got a great music scene.
Yeah,
it does. Did you, just out of curiosity, did you put the Spanish ballroom in the book?
I did. Yeah. So that was, I think that's just such a great venue. I haven't had a chance to see anything there yet, but the whole, you know, Elks Club and the fact that it was converted into McMenamin's, it's just such a great venue and a perfect location downtown.
It had just sat vacant for decades and it was just decaying. And it was amazing when McMenamin's came in and decided, you know, they tabbed that building.
Yeah. So if I was recommending, like, for someone to come visit Tacoma, I would stay out at Point Rustin now at the new Silver Cloud that's right there. It's just this stunning luxury hotel. And I think that was the one thing that area lacked to make it the perfect vacation destination. So you can go and stay at that hotel. It's got a fabulous restaurant in the, it's got a rooftop pool, which I think is pretty cool with, you know, all the, you've got that just stunning views of Commencement Bay, and you can see Mount Rainier, and and you're connected by, you can either walk or bike right into Point Defiance and then enjoy everything along the Point Reston and Reston Way.
You see, that's, you know, that's a huge, that whole area is a huge transformation that's been, I mean, that used to be just neglected area. And
Definitely. Well, is it Frank Herbert wrote Dune based on that, was a Superfund site. So in the 70s, it was one of the most polluted areas in the country. And that's what I just love, going out there too. I just feel like it's such hope for the environment when you can see this area that was just so polluted and, you know, just such a blight, you know, in the area, that it's been totally revitalized into this just great community. And it's amazingly Point Defiance, that park, you know, 100 years ago, the townspeople recognized what a beautiful place that was and preserved it. But, you know, even with all the pollution, it still survived that. So I think it's just a real neat hope for the environment story. And then they've kind of now with the new parks like Dune Peninsula Park and the Frank Herbert Trail, that's all kind of connecting, you know, right there between Point Reston and Point Defiance. It really shows a little insight on it, too. So.
Here's one. I got a question for you. See if you put this in the book. Did you put Bob's Java Jive?
Yes, I did. What a crazy place. And the history of it is just hysterical. Like my favorite, I guess, like rumor, you know, like people will say that, oh, Nirvana played there. But the rumor was the owner was like, no, Nirvana didn't play there because he didn't like them, you know, or something when they were just starting out. He didn't book them, I guess. So, they either did play there or they didn't play there.
That place has been just quirky forever.
Yeah, I think it was having some hard times during COVID, but there was like a GoFundMe site and everything, and I think they saved it for a little bit longer.
But it's just been one of those. It always seemed like it was hanging on by a thread, and you never quite knew how it was, you know, did they stay open? And then it would all of a sudden you'd hear people talk, hey, we went to the Java Jive again, and, well, you know, and it goes up. Anyway, it's a quirky space, and Tacoma.
Yeah, for your listeners that don't know what it is, it looks like a giant, I guess, coffee pot or teapot. It's been there forever, but it's a bar. It has nothing to do with coffee. So.
Nothing at all. Yeah, it was just a dive. Let's just call it a dive bar. It's just what it is. It's a dive bar, and it's.
It is.
But it's been that way forever. As a little kid, I remember it being just. Not questionable, but, you know, huh. And then as I grew up and when I could come back to Tacoma after being in college and all that, I'd go there and be like, oh, this place makes it. This is just, anyway, to me is, I don't want to say that's Tacoma to me, but to me that is, it is one of those iconic places in Tacoma that just is cool.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, so I include mostly Tacoma, but then I have a little venturing out a little bit further afield. You know, of course, I'm in Steilacoom, so I've got the Steilacoom Museums in there. And we have Farrell Marsh in Steilacoom, which is this really neat wetlands that's kind of been preserved. It's one of the city parks, so it's kind of a really neat place. Like, it's just down the street from my house, so I can walk up the hill and go out into this marsh and hike these trails, and a lot of volunteers in the city keep it up, so it's really a beautiful place to be. And then also DuPont was actually a DuPont company town. And so you have the newer section, but if you take exit 119 off of I-5, you can now access the Lewis Army Museum. And this is this big, huge white building. Like, people going up and down I-5 are probably always like, what's that building? It's one of the few surviving buildings on Joy Bass Lewis McChord from World War One era. And it was kind of like a recreation place, I think, for the soldiers. And then it served as an inn for a while. And then eventually it became the museum. And so in the probably the past 5 years, it's been renovated, I guess, or it's got more state-of-the-art exhibits now. And they've made a way where you can access the museum without having to go through the gate of JBLM. So from exit 119, you can exit park, and then you call, and then somebody comes and takes you through the gate and just walks you across the street to the museum.
Oh, okay. So you don't have to go through.
Right. And that's really, it's really incredible. And it's, you know, the history of JBLM is really a significant part of Tacoma, because actually Tacoma invited the base to be there. And I think people actually, I can't remember if they paid for the land, or there was a big story though about how, you know, the local community really wanted that base there. So that's kind of really, I think, unusual within, at least for Army bases, you know, as far as I know. So,
when you think about it, I mean, you alluded to some, well, you didn't allude, you flat out said it earlier. You know, when a military family goes to, let's say, JBLM, their family probably wants to come out and check out the Northwest if they're from, say, Wisconsin. And so it's good business to have these facilities in your area if you can.
Well, it is, and it brings so much to the local community, because I think there's 60 or 70,000 people live and work at JBLM, and I think it's the sixth or seventh largest city almost in Washington, you know, population wise. And then it contributes to the local community, because the kids that go to school, you know, the local schools, you know, the government provides them funds for those kids. And so it brings a lot into the area, as well as everybody, you know, eating at the restaurants, shopping at the shops, tourism.
So. Have you ever heard of the Mazama pocket gopher?
No, I have not.
Okay. So the Mazama pocket gopher is a endangered species. Have you ever watched the movie Caddyshack?
Yes.
Okay. So you remember the scenes where he's like going to, you know, takes the C4 and he's going to blow up the gopher that's tearing up the golf course. So this pocket gopher is in an endangered species. And I know this because when you are buying and selling property in Thurston County, there's parts of Thurston County where you have to do a gopher study before you can break ground, because if it's gopher habitat, you have to do some things to protect this endangered gopher. But one of the key locations of this endangered gopher is the Joint Base Lewis-McChord, where out kind of in the bombing ranges, where they're out, you know, throwing artillery shells. And it just makes me wonder, well, no wonder it's endangered if it wants to be where they're blowing shells up. That's just always kind of cracked me up. But yeah, so that base has this big endangered gopher population on its acreage.
Yeah, it's always some animal, you know, whatever base it is.
Yeah, a gopher. I mean, yeah, I'm sorry.
It was the red cockaded woodpecker. And
yeah, I just got a chuckle. Well, how long did the book take you to write, approximately?
Well, it probably took me a good, 6 months. So. Okay. Really not too terribly long. I think I'm planning on, depending on how this one does, I think hopefully I'll have a long-term relationship with Reedy Press, because I have some ideas for some other books as well. But it really wasn't too hard, because as far as word count goes, it was the equivalent of maybe 10 travel stories I write. I think it's about 15,000 words. So it's not a huge, lengthy book as far as reading, but I think that'll make it more enjoyable for a lot of people, because you can pick the book up and, you know, flip through it. Like, I'm bored today, or my kids are bored, you know, flip through it and just point to something. Okay, we're going to go do that today. So there's a lot of, I think, uses for it. And then, you know, it's more, I think, interesting descriptions and maybe unique things about places versus kind of, it's definitely not a feeders. There's some of those guidebooks where it's, you know, very specific, you know, it's here, it's open from this hours, this is how much it costs. You know, it just has the information on how to learn more about it. But you know, kind of my take on the place. So.
Okay.
Now, when is...
Oh, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I have to say, the best steak I've had in my entire life is in Tacoma. And as a travel writer, I get to eat a lot of very good restaurants. And it's Cuerno Bravo. And I mention it a lot all the time. And people are like, I've never heard of that. Where is it? And it's actually not too far from the McMenamins and the Elk Lodge. It's kind of up on the hill. But the owner is just super into just really good quality beef. So they carry everything from American Prime all the way up to Japanese Wagyu. And they serve it on sizzling stones. So like you'll order your steak. Like I like my medium rare. So you order it rare. And then you slice it and just kind of continue cooking it on the stones. It's just the perfect temperature. It's just, I
can't. Run that name by me again.
It's Cuerno Bravo. So
I've never heard of this place.
I know. And the thing is the guy opened just before COVID and then they had to shut down. And then I think they've been reopened maybe a year. But I think just word of mouth keeps them busy. I don't even think they need to advertise. So you just have to have somebody tell you about it.
You saw the look on my face, and this is an audio program, so nobody else got to see this. But I had this Doubting Thomas look on my face. You, as a travel writer, are claiming that the best steak you've had is in Tacoma. That's wild.
I've eaten steak all over the world, so I'm telling you, it's the best steak I've had in my entire life. It's that good.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. And so what's kind of neat about it is you can go in and you can order, you can go cheap and order, like they have a carne asada, which is made with Wagyu steak meal. Like some people go and just split that and order some other stuff. So you can go inexpensive, or you can go all the way up to, you know, Japanese Wagyu, which is kind of really high end. So I ordered, when I went, I had an American Prime. And my husband ordered, I think, the Australian Wagyu. So I took my first bite of my steak, and I was just like, I told my husband, this is the best steak I've ever had in my entire life, which I thought until I tasted his. And then once I tasted the Wagyu, I was like, oh, my gosh, you could definitely tell the difference.
You really could tell the difference, huh?
Right. Because, you know,
between two superior cuts of beef.
Very good. So Prime is... I think the highest you usually get in a grocery store is Choice. So Prime is kind of restaurant grade meat and very good. Wow. And then they do this, they're infamous for this baked potato. And it's, I don't even know how to describe it. It's almost like the size of like a small football. You know, it's just this, I've never seen a potato this big. And they just stuff it full of Wagyu beef, cheese, you know, just everything you could put on a baked potato. So it's, it could easily feed four people. So some people come and just order the baked potato for a meal. It's very good.
All right. Two questions.
I can see, I know the listeners can't see the expression on your face, but I'm cracking up because I know he's in disbelief, but I'm telling you,
I'm not in disbelief. It's more like, how do I get there? So yes. two questions. Well, question number one is, what cut of steak did you have and what cut of steak did your husband have? Were they the same cut?
I had the American Prime, and I can't remember. I don't think it was a rib. I'm trying to remember what it was. And then he had Australian Wagyu.
Okay. And approximately, what was the Wagyu steak?
Oh, price-wise?
Yeah, approximately.
I want to say there were different ones that started at like $69. And then went up to, I want to say the Japanese was, because there was American Wagyu Australian, and I think the Japanese, I want to say, was $89.95. But it was, the prices, I thought, you know, for some of the steak places, I thought was surprisingly reasonable.
That's a lot of money, don't get me wrong, but that's not a staggering amount of money versus going to, say, somebody like Morton's or someplace like that. Right. We're going to go to a super high-end steakhouse.
Yeah. And so
that's fascinating to me. You could have bet me a steak dinner and I would not have taken the bet that the best steak was in Tacoma. Just,
you know, I know.
I wouldn't have taken that bet. No.
So it's very good. And I like the atmosphere and I love the way they serve it. It's kind of unique. And, you know, they've got a... chimichurri sauce, and I think I'm trying to remember the other different sauces. I usually get them to bring me all of them because I'd love to try all the different sauces. But the, even meat just without the sauces was just melt in your mouth. It's so good.
Well, let me ask you my go-to question. We've kind of touched on it earlier, but you've talked steak, which is certainly up there for me, but coffee.
Okay, so coffee. So I made the mistake when I did the book. I wrote the coffee shop that I like, and I think I put one other, and I meant to come back and list some more, and I didn't. So that's a big fail on my part. But I love the Coffee Cabin in Steilacoom, but it's my neighborhood coffee shop, which is that has a lot to do with it. So I think, you know, when you're coming to Tacoma or you're moving here visiting, you kind of got to figure out what's your local coffee shop, you know, where you want to go. So in Steilacoom, you have the Coffee Cabin, and it's always popular, and they bake scones a couple times a week in there. So you've got that great bakery smell, and the coffee's good.
Is that adjacent to the Topsider?
It's right below Topsider. It's the same family. So it's a small family owned business. Mm-hmm. And the decor inside is just lovely. They've got paint mural of the mosquito fleet, you know, that used to roam mm-hmm. up and down the Puget Sound. And it's got kind of a nautical feel to it. Just beautiful blues and grays. And it's just so bright and cheery on a, you know, Pacific Northwest day with the rain and everything. So
I went there probably 3 years ago when I was doing this 100 cups of coffee in 100 days. Uh-huh. And I went there right around 4th of July. And so they had red, white, and blue bunting everywhere. Yeah, it was a great, you walk in, I was like, this is really a cool space.
It really is. It really, really is. It's cool really space, comfortable. Yeah. And it's, you always meet locals. I just love it. It's very community feel. And I think that's kind of what their goal was when they opened it, was to give a community space where people could meet and hang out.
Now let's take that one off the table because that's in your backyard, if you will. Let's go to Tacoma. I'm going to put you into Tacoma. Where's a good place for coffee in Tacoma?
Oh, I would say where's not a good place. I would say if you're coming to Tacoma, don't go to Starbucks. Go to, you know, go try a local place. So you've got everything from the drive-through coffee places. I'm trying to think of the different names. There's just every neighborhood has a coffee shop, and they're all really good. I mean, I don't think I've had a bad cup of coffee.
Did you ever try Valhalla on 6th Avenue? Valhalla? Did you ever try that one on 6th?
I don't think. I'm trying to think. What's the other one? Is it Metro?
There's the Metrodome.
Yeah, I've tried that one. But I don't think I've tried Valhalla, but I've seen it.
Yeah, Valhalla, and then there's Greybeard, right there by Jason Lee Middle School.
Okay. Yeah, there's just so many.
Trust me, you've driven past it. It used to be an old antique store. Yeah. But yeah, Tacoma's got. Washington State has great coffee. I mean, that's one of the coolest things about this.
We talked a lot about the sweet potato latte that, you know, right in the middle of Koreatown, you've got a great coffee shop. So I just
in a strip mall that doesn't look like it.
Right. I mean, and just the mixture of everything is so cool. And then, mm-hmm. of course, don't get me started on donuts.
go ahead.
Yeah, not enough room for all the great donut places. But, of course, I had to put Legendary Donuts. That's just incredible donuts.
I don't think I've ever had those.
Oh, you okay? So that's I think that's 6th Avenue too. I want to say, mm-hmm. and it's just the donuts are incredible. They're just so creative.
They're legendary.
Yeah. Yes. In fact, one year they do this big. It's some ginormous donut. I can't remember what it's called. I think maybe the Bigfoot or, you know, something along that line. So we got it for my son's birthday, and it was such a big donut. Like even after they ate it for birthday cake, we were slicing big hunks of it off to pass around to people in the neighborhood.
Please get this out of here. Please take it.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh my gosh. All right. Well, so with the book, when is the book being launched?
It's from what I've been told, it's supposed to be in the warehouse by September 1st of this year.
Looking forward to it. Where can people find the book? I mean, is it going to be everywhere?
I think so. So I know Well, one of my friends owns a store, Pine and Moss in DuPont, and she's definitely carrying it. Okay. You'll be able to find it at Barnes & Noble. I hope the independent bookstores will carry it. Yeah, so I think hopefully there'll be a variety of places that are going to have it. I think some of the museum gift shops are thinking about carrying it too. So they're in the process of doing all that right now. So
okay. Are you going to do any book tour for it? I mean,
I am, in fact, I'm not sure the date yet, but Ocean's 5 in Gig Harbor is going to do an event with me. So I'm looking forward to that. We're going to do a big book signing, and then they haven't finalized it yet, but they're looking at some fun things to do. And then the Silver Cloud in Point Reston, we're going to do something there, possibly do like a Tacoma themed cocktail, because their restaurant there is kind of known for their cocktails, their bar there. And then I'll do a book signing probably near the gift shop and everything. And then on the 15th of October, I'm doing a Tacoma trivia at the Lewis Army Museum. So that should be kind of fun. Yeah. So we're still working on all the different dates, but starting in October, probably through December, you'll find me around town at different times doing book signings and events.
Well, that'll be fun. That'll be fun for you.
Definitely. Well, I did want to point out about the book too. You know, a lot of people think, you know, when you're a writer and author, you're going to make, you know, a fortune on things like this. But for this, you know, maybe 6 months from now, I'll see, you know, a small royalty check. But this is really my love letter to Tacoma. As I said, I've moved 33 times and I just fell in love with this area. So it's just been such a joy to write about all these just wonderful small businesses in the area and the unique people that make this such a great place to live. So
I'm disappointed. I would have thought, you know, you would have gotten like a Harry Potter type advance.
Well, I feel like I deserve it. But Reedy Press is kind of a small, you know, niche publishing company, and they just publish mostly guidebooks, you know, and things like that. And then they also, like, if a school wants to write like a history of a building or things like that, they'll do a, you know, they have opportunities for people to publish that
quite one. Niche publishing then. Okay, well let me put you on the spot. You kind of said, you know, you had other ideas for books. Are they going to be along, I won't ask you to disclose like where, but are they going to be along kind of the same sort of thing, kind of like a bucket list type of book, or?
I think so. I definitely have a couple, 100 things to do before you die ideas for some two different areas within the region. And then I also want to, I don't know if it'll be with Reedy Press, because I have to see if they have a model that'll work for it. But I really want to write about Washington wine, and I really want to, you know, just kind of feature these different, because so many of the people, they're just small, you know, family-owned businesses. And I just love that aspect of, like, you can go wine tasting in Washington, and chances are the winemakers pouring your wine. And it's so... it's just so friendly and open, and it's not stuffy like, you know, some of the places you might find, like in Napa and everything. And I love the fact that it's people have that connection to their land too, with growing the grapes. So I think, I would love to write about Washington wine.
I have a friend of mine who lives they don't live in Washington State, and they are huge wine fans. Go so far as he has his own. He's bottled his own wines before.
Oh, wow. That's interesting.
And down in Napa. And he's not from California, but he went to Napa to do this. And, you know, so Napa, I don't know anything about wines per se, but, you know, there's all these famous wineries in Napa, right? And Napa was the epicenter of the U.S. wine.
Okay.
And then you go to Walla Walla, and have you... You've been to Walla Walla, right?
I've been to Walla Walla, but I think if you really want to taste Washington wines it depends. If you want volume, you know, quantity, go to Woodinville, because there's over 140 wineries have tasting rooms there. So you can, in a weekend, taste probably like everything all around the state. But to get, you know, to be actually where the wine's made and everything, then you want to go to like Walla Walla, or also the Tri-Cities area is really, I enjoy that as well. Because I think it gives you a little more of a variety too. So.
Right.
But Walla Walla, downtown Walla Walla cracks me up because to me, downtown Walla Walla is like downtown Seattle. But in other words, when you go to downtown Seattle, you can't, like if you go to Starbucks in downtown Seattle, I think they strategically figured out exactly how many steps it is before your drink will be finished. And then there'll be another Starbucks, like one step beyond. Walla Walla is that way with wineries that you can't not turn and not see a bunch of wineries. But there was a t-shirt and I saw it and I wanted to buy it. And I didn't because I wanted to give it to my friend because he's such a, I don't want to call him a wine snob, but he's a wine snob. And it said, Walla Walla is for wine. Napa is for auto parts.
Oh. That is funny.
I just love that shirt. And Walla Walla is a fun place to go. I think the whole idea of doing a book on Washington wines would be amazing. And it would be a lot of work because there's so many wineries.
Well, here I was almost thinking within this 100 things to do before you die, you know, like maybe Washington wine country, you could almost fit into that because I was thinking the different categories because there's wineries that have great places to eat, you know, and restaurants. So mm-hmm. you could include those under that. And then I've been to wineries like with sports and recreation. I've been to one where they play, it's not bocce ball, but there's another game and it's French. I cannot remember the name of it, but it was just like this quirky thing. And there's this whole group of people that really love this particular sport, you know, so, and they play it a lot at this one winery. And so okay. There's so many things that I think you could fit it into it. Cause some of these wineries have different things, you know, there's another one that offers horseback riding, you know, or, rides through the trail. Through the vineyards and stuff. So I think it could possibly fit into all those different things. And then I've been to some wineries that just have great shops, you know, of cool stuff to buy. So I think there's probably enough to fit it all in there. So.
I'm sure there is. Well, couple things as we wrap up here. One, where can people find more out about you and your writing?
You can go to peggywhereshouldigo.com. And that's my website, and I'm in the process of adding all the stuff about the book. So you'll see some pages pop up there, probably either the end of this week or early next week.
Okay.
And then I'm also on Instagram as Peggy. Where should I go? And that's I really love Instagram. It's kind of my happy place. I love being able to post fun pictures, and I never do anything political. It's always just happy stuff. So.
I love the name, Peggy. Where should I go? That's
well,
that's
it's
great.
Interesting how that came about because people know I'm a travel writer, and they also know. Well, I've just always loved to travel, so even before I was writing, people would ask me, "Oh, you know, I want to go somewhere for a long weekend. You know, Peggy, where should I go?" So I was like, "That's what people are always asking me." So I was reading a lot about branding, and it says, "Well, what do you offer?" Not thinking about, you know, when you're doing a website, what you want to write about, but what is your audience and what do they want? And then I started thinking about it, like that was, that's what everybody asked me. So that's how that came
about. That's great. All right. So my get out of jail free question. What didn't I ask you that I should have?
Oh, let me see. Well, we talked about the best food. I don't know. I think you did pretty good. I think you covered everything I wanted to talk about. So that's good.
Actually, we're gonna end this one on a negative note. All right. I shouldn't do it this way, but we're going to put you on the spot negatively. Tell me something about Tacoma that you don't like.
Let's see. Well, I think like any city, Tacoma still struggles with a homeless problem. Okay. And I don't think it's as bad as Seattle or Portland, but that's kind of a tragic situation. But I also think we've got a lot of resources here that seem like it's really helped. You know, like I feel like people that are homeless, there's a place they can go get a meal. I've done some volunteer work myself, you know, I don't do it regularly, but like in the cold, they'll open up additional shelters. So I've helped work with some friends doing meals and everything. And so I think the community is very conscious of it, but you know, it's something people should be aware of, but I don't really see it too much. Like in the museum districts, it tends to be a little further out, but so I think that would probably be the one negative.
So mine, the thing I dislike about Tacoma, I-5.
Oh, the traffic.
The I-5, that from Fife to 512.
Oh, yeah. Around the Tacoma Dome, that like checkpoint. Well, they're getting close to finishing the road. Like, that's one thing living out here. I'm just amazed. Like, and maybe it's because of the way the weather is and everything, but I just, you actually see stuff getting done because I've lived, you know, like in Louisiana, I can remember going back to visit family and the roads, they've been working on it, you know, for 10, 20 years and it just doesn't, well, never seems to get fixed. It
feels like they've been working on that for 10 or 20 years.
Yeah, but probably have, but you can actually see stuff getting done. So I think that's close to being finished, but you don't have to get on I-5 though. There's so many ways to get around. I mean, if you just like going through, but you can get around without having to go on I-5.
That stretch probably from Fife to probably the Tacoma Mall. If I'm fair, once you get past the mall, it's typically okay. But that stretch where you're weaving in and out now, and you don't know where you're going, and or at least I don't because I don't go over enough anymore. That to me is the one thing I can say I don't like about Tacoma. Yeah. And now I'll get complaints about that, but that's okay. Because traffic's terrible.
Well, I think it's definitely not the Tacoma you grew up in. I can say that. Oh, you know, when you were telling me in the pre-interview, you know, kind of your impression of it. I think it's a totally different feel from when you grew up here.
Much, much, much has changed about Tacoma. Yes. And most, frankly, most of it for the better. Yes. Some things, not so much. But that's you can say that about everywhere in the world. But Tacoma, you know, what's funny is that when I grew up, I couldn't wait to get away. I went to college, moved to Seattle, ended up back in Tacoma because of my kids. We lived in the Stadium District when they were going to school. They both went to Stadium High School. And then I couldn't wait to get out of there again. I love Stadium District, but I just didn't like, I was working, you know, commuting. Stadium District is, with the water, Point Defiance, all of that's wonderful.
I really do. It really is, yeah.
But, yeah, overall, Tacoma has, I think it gets a, you know, like, the grit city. The whole grit city thing that they like to perpetrate.
Yeah.
I don't think that's helping.
Well, I think
the sense that it's not as gritty as we want it to be anymore. It's becoming, you know, it's becoming more.
Well, I think too, you know, it's the Seattle Tacoma Airport and the majority of the people that come, you know, out west to visit the Pacific Northwest gravitate to Seattle versus Tacoma. So I'm hoping this book with Reedy Press, because it's a national company, is going to kind of spotlight Tacoma a little bit as a travel destination.
Yeah. All right. Well, I hate to end on a negative note. Put you back on the spot.
Well, you know, I'm going to try and turn it around to something positive.
So. No. Okay. Here's one for you. Because we talked about lunch. We kind of talked. You threw the best steak thing going in, which I got to tell you, that's a huge takeaway for me. Where's a great place for breakfast in Tacoma?
Oh, my gosh. So, I love the Art House Cafe in the Stadium District. That's a fabulous, you know, kind of, I think, more fancy brunch. And then, let's see. And so Lakewood is, you know, part of, you know, just coming out of Tacoma. You have Cars. And there's all these just places that have been around for like a bunch of years. Cars is crazy. You plan to wait because it takes forever to get in there and get in early. But you'll bring home. I just can't believe how huge the servings are. Like a family of four could probably split the pancake meal. It's that big.
I get a kick that they have the paddles, the shocking paddles at every booth so that when you have the heart attack with breakfast that you can just recess it.
Well, then,
I ate there once not realizing what the portions would be. And I was like, I mean, it took like two people to carry the plate out. It was crazy what they're serving. It was absolutely insane.
One place that has a good reputation too, I haven't eaten there yet, but I've been dying to just because of the name, is the Poodle Dog. So it's, I'm trying to remember where that's at. It's in Tacoma.
Fife. It's in Fife.
Fife, yeah.
Fife.
That just was always intriguing to me.
That was my mom and dad's favorite place. They would go there either every Saturday or every, you know, on Saturday or on Sunday one, and maybe sometimes both days. And I would meet them there oftentimes for, you know, I'd grab coffee with them there.
And if you like a lighter breakfast, pretty much every coffee shop has a nice selection of pastries and breakfast sandwiches. So that's always an option too.
Yeah. Well, thank you for taking the time to chat with me today. I really appreciate
You're
it.
Welcome.
And I'm looking forward to checking the book out when it's launched.
Oh, thank you so much. And thank you for having me. I really, like I said, I really love talking about my adopted home. So.
All right. Thank you.
Join us next time for another episode of the Exploring Washington State podcast.